You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and if my timings are correct, this is episode 316. So, with that being said, I've got to invite back the baddest man in the New Age clique. Thought maybe he'd be able with the rest of the guys. But the brand new member of the New Age clique, back from South Africa, last time we had a chat with him, it's Irn Dru Marshall. Welcome back on.
How are we doing, buddy? Thank you very much for having us again.
I know. Well, last time it was kind of a bit, we had a little bit of time because you were between, you're traveling, places. So we thought we'd have a little chat about South Africa and what have you. And then we'd get you back on and do a proper like interview at some point. Aye. And here we are. What is it? Like 7 months later, which, you know.
Aye, close to that. But...
So we'll catch up from where we left off then. South Africa. Against Mr. Wrestling. How was that experience for you?
Wow, it was amazing. Seriously, like getting to go over to South Africa, getting to see their culture. You know, the different, like obviously, you know, it's a different country in it. It was an experience. I've loved it. I'd absolutely love to go back. You know what I mean? It's definitely something I would love to do again. But like, just it was wild as well. Like, just like the nightlife. We were told specifically, like, you do not leave your hotel after 8 PM at night, regardless of like if it's dark or light, unless you've got an escort there. So, obviously, standing at the hotel window, looking outside, there were just riots everywhere. Mate, honestly, it was crazy, absolutely wild. We were literally about maybe 20 feet away from a petrol station, and we couldn't go over there unless we were escorted by a local. Wow, amazing. And then, like, the show, it was at a music festival, like a mini transmit, if you want to call it that. Like there was something like there was 14,000 people that attended the event, but I could be wrong with the number. That's why I'm thinking there. I'm pausing. Was it 14,000 or 24,000? I can't really remember. But. Wow, just the passion of the people there. Like the you can tell they don't really have a lot of wrestling. So like there was before we went on, you had the local amateur wrestling team, well, the Olympic wrestling team, if you want to, for those who don't know. And these, there was like kids from like 3 years old up to 12 years old in the ring doing all the Olympic like wrestling and like just doing like wee exhibition matches and stuff. It was quite good to see. You know what I mean? They had the ring that we were in was an old WWE ring that was left over there on like one of the South African tours that they'd done many years ago. But I know it was good. And then like getting to wrestle Mr. Wrestling, it was an experience. This is you like, obviously, I don't know if you've managed to find any of these matches on YouTube or that. He's very charismatic, and that's what gets him over with the fans. He's just, well, he looks like Hulk Hogan if you order them from Wish.com, you know what I mean?
So what are you saying is you wrestle South Africa's Hulk Hogan in a WWE ring?
If you want to go that far, you know what I mean? It was good. I think he said he was 62 years old, And he wanted me to give him a superplex for the top rope. And I'm thinking, nah, mate, like that's no happening. I'm no suplexing you for the top rope. That's no. I managed to convince, like, to talk him around and say, like, listen, buddy, I don't feel comfortable suplexing a 62-year-old man. Like, and don't get me wrong, like, by all means, it's not just because he's a 62-year-old man. He was complaining about his back. He's got, like, bad knees. He says his back was killing him. He was in agony. He was going to pull out of the match. Like, stuff like that. And he's like, brother, you end match with top rope suplex. Yeah. I'm like, no chance. That's not happening. No.
So he just, no. Like, breaks, like a glass ornament at the end of it.
I know. I mean, like, within a more basic... I say basic finish, more an easier finish. I came off the top with a frog splash, and I said to him, if I can get the momentum to, like, come back up high enough, if you just hook the head, hook the leg, turn over, pin me, steal the cover, 1, 2, 3, you know what I mean, big celebration. Hits him with the frog splash. I get to the height, but then I just feel myself coming straight back down. I hook his neck, hook his leg, and I'm like, roll over. And he's going, what, brother? What the fuck it? Oh, fuck it. And I've just rolled myself onto my back, pulled him over, and then rolled myself onto my shoulders. Like, 1, 2, 3. I'm like, for fuck, I had to pin myself, man. But I.
Experience seems to be the right word then, between looking out the window to riots and then beating yourself. But they say it's one of those once in a lifetime things that you could do. When it comes to the ring, though, like WWE rings generally are 20x20, and most of the ones in the UK are like, what, 16? 14, 16?
Majority, yeah. 16.
So I don't know if WAW have a 20-foot ring, but is that something you have to adjust to, or is it something you've worked in before?
Well, WAW, they've got an old TNA ring from when TNA done the Maximum Impact tools in the UK. So I think I'm sure it's either an 18 or a 20. But you need to slightly adjust. Do you know what I mean? Like, obviously you've got more space. You know what I mean? So it kind of, I can work in your favour, but at the same time it can hinder you in a way, if that makes sense, because you've got your ring awareness, but then you've still got this big area. You don't want to just stick to one spot in the ring, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so I watch the bad guys try to pad out, and they do like 3 rolls on the right of the ring, and then they do 3 rolls, exactly. And they're still there. And like,
aye, do you know what I mean? Like, just simple things, like if you're sending your opponent off and you go for like a sleep and a leap, you know what I mean? You've still got, you need to, when you're going for the sleep, you need to, obviously you've got to try and trip your opponent up, so you need to jump that extra bit further, and then obviously your opponent, even though your opponent's still got more space to run, it gives you more space to get up, to come up for the leapfrog. Obviously, if your opponent's running at 100 miles an hour, and you're going at 100 miles an hour, you know what I mean? It's like you've got that timing and that connection. So, I mean, obviously.
So that experience in itself, coming back to these, you know, kind of calm shows, and then a couple months later, was it, not even a couple months later, you were in the ring fighting for the NWA Worlds Championship.
A week later.
EC3, a week later. You're in with EC3, NWA. I mean, we did the research on this. I think that's the first time since, what, the 1960s or something like that?
1968.
Which is mad, right? The fact that you were that close, a whisker away from that £10 of gold, and the fact first person to be competing for it in just about 60 years, well, about 55 years. What was it like going into that match and just the whole... Was there an added pressure to it because of that kind of historic slant to it?
Well, to be honest, like, going into the match, I don't know if you noticed, but on the match graphic, it was never actually advertised as an NWA Worlds title match. It was just Irn Dru versus EC3. And in the afternoon, EC3 done he calls it a wrestling workshop, so it wasn't really a wrestling seminar. It was more of a workshop on how to develop your character and stuff. And I went over and Sweet Soraya had introduced us to each other. And he'd said, like, you know what I mean, like, he's looking forward to working with me, all that stuff. And I'm thinking, that's quite, like, respectful, but obviously at the same time, probably saying this to every guy that you're wrestling, so just take it with a pinch of salt. Don't think big of yourself or anything like that. You know, we go backstage and like we're talking about the match and we're throwing ideas back and forth to each other, and he's like, I came up with a finish. He quite enjoyed, he liked the idea of the finish. He's like, I'm going to take that back home. I'm going to steal that. And then all of a sudden, we're getting changed, and I'm going over the match in my head, and you know, like, try to get this down to a T. Because again, it, regardless if it's a title match or not, I'm still wrestling EC3, who is at the time the NWA World's Heavyweight Champion. So I still want to at least leave an impression with him, as well as represent WAW. So I'm getting changed and I'm going through the match, and all of a sudden Sweet Soraya appears, and she shouts, Sam, so you boys have got this ready, he's done, yep, all good, yep. So are we gonna put the belt on the line, or is it just going to be a standard match? And EC3's just sort of looked up and he's gone, yeah, let's put the belt on the line. And my arse just collapsed. I'm like, and Sweet Soraya was, she, like, to be fair, she wasn't even looking in my direction, and she's just gone, and I can tell you right now that his jaw is touching the floor, and I'm like, holy fuck, it's actually going to be a titles match. Wow, this is unreal. And then like, just like listening to EC3, like when he was like going over the match and like doing like the workshop and stuff, I actually learned quite a lot for EC3. I would go as far as saying it's probably one of my top favourite matches I've been involved in, not because of the prestige of the belt, but just being able to go out there and say that I could hang with the world champion, you know what I mean? So that was a bonus. Say there was at one point in the match, we're both, wasn't so much a double down, but we're both on the deck at one point, both on the canvas, and I'm like, fuck, oh, I feel under pressure. Shit, what's next? And I'm going, what's next? And he's going, I was about to ask you. I don't fucking know. I'm like, oh no, shit, we're fucked. And then literally just the both of us just, it just clicked, and we've instantly got the next, you know, the next spot and carried on. But again, just, it was an experience, something that I can happily sit here and say that I'm the only person in this current generation that's done that.
It's one of those things where like, the must, yeah, say the pressure is on, you're saying like that, but as soon as you know he forgot as well, you're like, he's been doing this for in the biggest rings and arenas in the
exactly.
world. If he's forgotten, then I think we'll be all right. You know,
I 100%. You know what I mean? But like, for me personally, like growing up watching wrestling, like for me, my biggest like standout things to me was like the golden era and the attitude era of WWE or WWF at the time. But when it comes to belts, like I remember having the old WCW videotapes, and it was the NWA Worlds Title. There was always a tournament for the belt, and it was Ric Flair was the NWA World Champion, and he was unstoppable, and like he just carried. He made the belt. These wrestlers made the belt. I'd probably actually go as far as saying the NWA belt is probably the only belt in wrestling that's actually made a wrestler rather than the wrestler that making the belt. So, but for me, it was a big deal because it was always the NWA title that was a big deal to me. That was the, growing up, before I knew the ins and outs of wrestling, that was the number one belt. It was the world belt. You know what I mean? Because WWF was the WWF heavyweight. It wasn't the world heavyweight at the time. So the NWA World's Heavyweight title, to me, that was like, holy shit, man. NWA World's Heavyweight title shot. If you were to tell 5-year-old me, he'd be buzzing right now.
I always loved that belt. I mean, I came in a little bit later because I started actually at a time. So when I watched all the WCW tapes, it was the big gold at the time. So TNA is when I saw this belt, and I was
exactly.
Like, holy shit. But it looked... It looked so different because it was like rectangular. It was a bit of an odd shape in comparison to other belts. And then I don't know why, but the way Jeff Jarrett held it, like he had it over the shoulder and then had it clipped underneath, so it didn't drape down. I thought that is the coolest way to wear a belt. Like it takes someone with confidence to hold it like that. Because if I take one of these things I won off eBay, it's a victory. And I do it, it doesn't look the same. It doesn't look as cool. No. But when Jeff Jarrett did it, I was like, oh man, that is a really cool belt. But no, it's I mean, NWA, it's kind of went through its ups and downs in that, but I think generally the consensus is it's still one of the most beautiful belts in professional wrestling. Did you get a sneaky hold of it though? Did you get a chance to feel that £10?
You're fucking right, I did. And I waited till it was in the match.
So you get the photo
in the match. Well, right. So this is the thing. It was one of the female wrestlers at WAW. I managed just to catch her just before we were going out. I says, look, listen, I'm going to jump him. We've no planned this, but I'm going to jump him from behind. And when he drops to the deck, I'm going to pick the belt up and I'm just going to hold it over my head like this. Get as many pictures of me as you can. Like, just try and get a picture of me. She's like, yep, no worries. I will do. Perfect. So I goes over, jump start right away. Picks the belt up, doing the whole dramatic, looking at it, you know what I mean? Picking it up over the shoulder. I looks over and I'm going, where the fuck is she? I don't see her. Shit. And the referee comes over right away and just takes the belt. And I'm thinking, I fucking hope she's somewhere in this building and she got that picture. Oh my God. No, she thought I meant during the entrance, take pictures of me holding my belt up in the air. Because I was I had the WAW World like heavyweight title at the time. So I was holding that in there and she snapped like 30 pictures and then sent them to me. I'm like, wrong belt. Never mind. But I've got the footage of the match, so I could always just screenshot me holding the belt up before the referee quickly snatches it.
Well, that's 8x10s at the merch stand. I mean,
exactly.
That's a couple of quid in your pocket, or at the very least, you're just gonna have to get. Is it Thomas Latimer that's the NWA champion now? You're just gonna have to get him. I'm sure the Knights know him very well. They'll have him back over, and for round two. So the big thing that's been happening since we last had a chat back in March is Valor getting involved with Valor Wrestling, and just a little thing as the reboot of the New Age Click with Chris Renfrew, and Cavero was revealed as the first new member of the faction, and then you're revealed not long afterwards. Was it Most Wanted or was it just before Most Wanted?
Most Wanted, Paisley. Most Wanted, the first Paisley show.
So we do have a question about it, but I'll ask that in a second though. But yeah, getting involved like Renfrew again, very polarizing figure in wrestling. He's coming back with Valor. What was your reaction to seeing him return to wrestling?
To be honest, I've never had any issues with Chris Renfrew. I know certain people have had issues, other wrestlers and fans or whatever. I've never had issues. There was the one time at an SWA show in Easter House. I was a trainee. I was a trainee at the time, and I paid for a ticket, and I got front row at Easter House, and Renfrew tried to give me a worked shot, and completely misjudged it, smashed me in the nose. My nose was hanging to the side a little bit, and my nose was absolutely pissed in my blood. But apart from that, I've never had an issue with Renfrew. So I remember getting told that there was the talks at NAK potentially coming back. Then I was told straight away, Drew, we are putting you in NAK, you're going to be the first guy, and Renfrew's coming back as well. And I'm thinking, that'll be good. Like, let's see what buzz we can generate here. Because again, it's Valor's a new company, it's a new scene, and there's doors open, so to speak, for multiple people to come back within reason. I'm not going to sit here and say everybody is welcome back, because that's not the case. Obviously, we understand, we all know why, with the Speak Out movement and stuff. But personally, I'm looking forward to seeing what's going to come 2 with the new version of the NAK, and I look forward to seeing the crowds that we're going to start drawing simply because we've got people like Chris Renfrew coming back.
So you we'll probably speak about that a bit more, but you were on the first you're on the first Valor show, weren't you? The first official Valor show, because I watched that. It's just on YouTube now for folk that want to go watch it. There really is that underground movement within Valor that reminds me, and not just because Renfrew's involved now, but it does remind me of how ICW was perceived way back when, which all just is now spiraling and going further and further. Did you see that shift at all? Because when you started the Valor shows and the Copenhagen shows beforehand, it was in like in Kirkintilloch, it was in nice friendly clean venues, and then you go to the Opry, which is this down and dirty kind of underground kind of atmosphere. Did you feel the shift of the Valor shows into that direction while you were on those shows?
I probably felt the shift when we done the first Opry show, Red Dead Wrestling, the first one, because every match on the card had a stipulation. I was in the pre-show match and it was a bunkhouse brawl. Everybody came out with weapons. Obviously, it was the Valor management provided the weapons, unless you messaged them and says, "Oh, I've got this weapon." and I was given a glass bottle of Iron Brew and a packet of Roundtree randoms. That was my weapons. Everybody else had legit weapons, and I'm like, all right, okay. But everybody that had a weapon, I took it after them and hit them with their own weapon. You know what I mean? But I started to notice that we were getting, like, when you look at like the shows in like Kirkintilloch and stuff, right? When we first done the Kirkintilloch shows, we were drawing majority families, like family style show, and then we go to the Opry and there's more of an adult vibe there. There's more like adults and children. Then you go to Paisley and there was not one child in sight. It was all adults. And then all of a sudden it was, you go back to Kirkintilloch and it's family shows. The families turn up. You go back to the Opry and there's less children, more adults. You go to Paisley, there's even more adults and there's still zero children. So you still have that option to the variety of different shows that the Valor's got. Whereas if you take ICW into consideration when they first started, they were straight up over 18s, ultraviolet, every match had near rules, all that type of stuff. You know what I mean? So Valor's doing something different. We've got to cater to all different like varieties. So you've got your family and you've got your over 18s. You know what I mean? You all will also do a gala day, which is, again, it's a family-friendly style show. Then you've got the shows that you do in Sweden. It's in a nightclub, over 18s. You know what I mean? There's no kids, all adults. So I think it's kind of a stem from, if you go back to CC, like, but it was because obviously Valor was originally CCW, Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. So when you take the original shows from Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, which were all family friendly shows, and then you go to Sweden, which was Seb Silver's promotion, Svensk Wrestling Sid, I believe. I could be wrong on that one, I'm not sure. I know there's another promotion very, very similar. The two names are very similar to each other. But so then you take their over 18 style shows that are in the nightclubs and you bring the two of them together, and you became Valor. We've got the family-friendly shows in Kirkintilloch. We've got the over-14s, shall we call it, at the Opry. And then you've got your over-18s in Paisley.
It's a fascinating project, because for that exact reason, like you're saying, it does, the shows, depending where you go, it caters, but there's still a through-line story between all those kinds of shows at the same time, which... I mean, the guys like Seb, Sebastian Day and Lou that are putting this together, as a project, is incredible. And then you couple in the factor that they've got that going on, and then the last year we've had Bleeding Gums come around as well, and it feels like, I mean, Scottish wrestling still is a very like tense place. You know, something will break the straw on the camel's back. But the fact that the promotions are taking more conceded like risks now, like Bleeding Gums, like Valor, it's very exciting. And that's just as a fan, I suppose, as a wrestler, that it's creating these different opportunities. Like, I mean, of course, you went to South Africa, you fought for the NWA Worlds Title, but now you can kind of scratch a niche if you want to maybe go do, if you want to try deathmatch wrestling, if that's something that you think, right, I think I could do this, then you can contact Bleeding Gums and do that, or do it at Valor because they just had Texas Deathmatch. It's just it's a very yeah, wrestling in Scotland certainly is certainly increasing its variety of styles. And like I say, as a wrestler, you must find that just exciting to be able to do.
I mean, it's exciting to see, you know what I mean? It's opening doors to, like you say yourself, different varieties of wrestling, different styles of wrestling. For me personally, obviously, I've been asked several times, would I do deathmatch? Or would I do a deathmatch or like some sort of deathmatch tournament or something like that? I don't know. It doesn't appeal to me at all. I mean, I enjoy watching. Like, I used to, growing up, I used to love the hardcore division. I used to literally live for the hardcore division. And then growing up, then you would start seeing CZW, and I would watch all your tournaments of death, and I watched deathmatch wrestling. Not so much now, I've not watched it for a wee while. I was intrigued, and then obviously I started seeing when like they started bringing in like them, I think they call them Tenzans or something. It's like a wooden block with like the 40 small nails, and they're sticking into your skull. And I'm thinking, this isn't wrestling. This is just guys who can't wrestle. And by all means, I'm not saying all deathmatch wrestlers cannot wrestle. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that at all. But like 50% of them will go as far as saying they can't wrestle, so they get over by smashing shit over their head or sticking needles, syringes through their cheeks. And that's no for me.
I think what I'm learning, because I deathmatch wrestling was never for me, and you know, I'm still like kind of but there's a show coming up in November for Bleeding Gums, and I was like, you know what, I might actually give this a go. But it seems to be, when I'm speaking to the guys there, I mean, this is you have wrestled for them, so this is weird, very weird. I've went into this kind of tangent. We'll get back out of it, trust me. But it seems to be a case of if a deathmatch wrestler can tell a story, then that's how they make, that's a good deathmatch wrestler. I think that Andy there doesn't like just like violence for the sake of violence. He needs a reason for it, and I think that's why I'm starting to get drawn towards it. He's somehow, I've started being terrified of deathmatch wrestling, and over the year he's kind of went, but there's stories and people are telling me, but there's reasons for what they do in these in these moments. I'm like, all right.
See, I'm no knowledgeable to that stuff. Do you know what I mean? Like, I remember speaking to a few guys that I know, like good friends of mine that do the deathmatch wrestling. And I'm like, right, come on, tell me, how do you gimmick this? How do you make that? How do you do that? Like, without actually, like, what's the trick? And they're like, oh no, it's actually a syringe that you're putting through your cheek. Fuck off. No, it is. How do you do the bamboo sticks? Like, no, we actually, like, you put it in the soft part of your skull and you fucking whack it. Are you for real? Are you trying to, you ribbing me here? See, no, it's real. Nah, I'm not getting myself scarred up for nothing. Nah, I'm good. Thank you.
We'll move away from that because it's something that we'll both end up just going, this is terrible. But like I say, I've certainly been more intrigued about it than I have in the last 33 years beforehand. It's interesting. But like I say, we've got the variety now in it. So we do have the question about the NAK, which we'll kind of answer now, which is Caden_Burke on Instagram. How did you feel when you got the call from Renfrew to join the NAK? So what was that first conversation with Renfrew like when this whole thing was coming together?
It wasn't Renfrew that told me. So my first conversation with Renfrew was when Renfrew came back at the Opry, I believe.
That Ring of Fire, was it?
Yes. So that's when Renfrew came back. I was initially told by Luke King Sharp Blue King Sharp was over at my house playing some video games, and that's when he told me that NAK was coming back and he's choosing me to be a part of the NAK. And I remember thinking, oh, 50-50, I'm in two minds of this. For me, this growing up in the Scottish scene through my wrestling training and stuff like that, and like coming through the business, NAK were the fucking the mutts nuts. Like I always said, if I ever get the chance, I'd join NAK. I believe that my old character Max Mayhem, which was a fucking streak of piss, I believe that he had some sort of potential to push in the NAK. But then when Luke King Sharp said to me, he's like, listen, I believe that you've got something inside you that we've not seen yet. I believe we've got a side of you that you can show to the fans and you can maybe express it in the NAK, because I believe that you've got this monster inside of you, so to speak. That wasn't his words, but and I'm thinking, right, cool, let's see what happens. And turns out he was telling me that the unveiling would be at Paisley. I'm thinking, cool, that's fine. And he gave me the idea that he wanted. We came to an agreement on how I would be unveiled. And I just remember he said, Renfrew said to me, just relax and just soak it in. And I remember saying, I'm not being funny though. The other 50% of me is saying, this ain't going to benefit your career, and this is going to generate you some heat backstage or for other promotions and other wrestlers. So you need to tread carefully on what you're doing here. And I'm like, right, okay, let's maybe speak to some guys who I may think have an issue about it. And they basically didn't really give two shits.
The thing that's going into details and all sorts of controversial subjects, I think it seemed to be a case of everything that came out speaking out, Renfrew wasn't really in that circle of things. So really, no. There's bigger fish to fry. There's worse
of
things
course.
Going on
but
in there.
I was also thinking the same thing is like NAK was originally an ICW thing.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
So I'm thinking, is this going to generate heat towards me and towards Valor from ICW? Do you know what I mean? Luckily, I've managed to stay away from the politics side of things, and so I physically couldn't even say if anybody at ICW has even commented or anything. I'm pretty sure there probably has been, there probably hasn't been. It is what it is. But, when it came to the unveiling, I'm going to go as far as, I could be wrong, I'm going to go as far as saying I was the first one to openly swear. Like, when it wasn't a match or like a spot or a situation with somebody getting hit with a chair. I remember just super kicking Luke King Sharp in the back of the head a wee bit too hard. Took out Krieger, stood above him, and took the mask off, and I just shouted, get it right fucking up you. And that was like, everybody's like, oh, he swore. And then the next show, we were at the Opry, we'd done the Glasgow street fight. Every match before it was your clean cut family match, or your family wrestling match. Comes to main event, during my entrance, I'm cursing and swearing and blinding and effing and fucking and counting and everything at everybody. And the genuine heat that was getting generated between me, Renfrew, and Cavaro, just by swearing and the people swearing back at us, it's almost like an original ECW feeling. But obviously, I wasn't there for ECW, the original ECW feelings. I can only imagine this is what it feels like. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally, like there's a fan who comes to every Valor show. He genuinely fucking hates Irn Dru with a passion. And I think it's only because one reason, because his favourite wrestler is Ravy Davey, and I beat Ravy Davey at Lochwinnock, and he was there, you know what I mean? And he was Ravy, the guy's Ravy Davey Daft. And every match ever since, every show, he's even when I was the face, I was a good guy, he was giving me nothing but shit swearing, saying that I suck, I'm a fucking arsehole, all this stuff. You know what I mean? There was, why the cock until it shows, Crowbar actually physically manhandled the guy out of the building.
Yes. It was the first one that they put out. The footage had that in there, and then it
Aye.
went down and it cut it out and took it and put it back
Aye.
up. But I was there, I saw the first cut of it, and I was like,
That was
that
legit.
was amazing.
That was legit. That wasn't part of a show or nothing. The guy started shouting race, like racial stuff towards Eastern Bloc, and Crowbar was like, "Nah, that's not happening," and literally just physically grabbed the guy and launched him out. So obviously, I mean, you've seen the video. But like the past show there, like that guy was literally like the guy gets so invested in the storylines and in the matches and the characters, like. Me and the guy were just bouncing off each other with the insults, everything. Seb Silver's turns on Glasgow Grindhouse, we unveil him as the fourth member. The guy literally stands up, puts his jacket on, rips his jacket back off, starts shouting and bawling, going mental. And then you'll probably see the video online of me jumping up on the middle, on the top rope, and I'm like, I literally just I get lost in the moment. I literally, because the crowd is erupting. The noise in that building was unbelievable, and I've literally just got lost in the moment. And I climbed the top turnbuckle, my 2 feet slipped off the middle rope, but I managed to catch myself, and it looks quite elegant, to be fair. It was actually a pure accident. I've managed to catch myself, and it's almost like I'm dry humping the top ropes. I just start bouncing with my hips, and I'm looking at the guy, and I'm like, "Look at you fucking asshole!" And I'm just going mental, and then I'm like. Oh, you better calm down, like calm down, calm down. And then the next thing, like the guy's looking at me, and I'm thinking, he's invested in this storyline. He doesn't believe that this is real, and it's just clicked. The next thing, he's throwing trash at me, and I'm like, you missed, you fucking missed. Just see new joining, being part of the NAK, and just having that wee bit of freedom to bring something else up to generate the heat. You know what I mean, like. It goes back to when I wrestled when I worked DC3, and he says at these wee workshop that he was told for John Cena that your wrestling character should be one of two things: either yourself times 10, like tight, like literally turn it all the way up, like over exaggerate yourself completely, or you become like your character should be somebody that you genuinely hate. Now, so if you're a good guy. Times yourself up times by 10, or bad guy, you become somebody that you genuinely hate. So, I hate gym rats. I hate people who sit in their rooms and do podcasts, and they're sitting in vests, and they've got their muscles at own show. I hate people that constantly put gym pictures up on Instagram or social or your social medias and throw it right in your face. I hate it. I genuinely, I'm like, oh, you cringy bastards. So Irn Dru has become, it's Irn Dru, no Dru Marshall, the person. Irn Dru is now the person that Dru Marshall hates. Irn Dru is a gym rat. My post will say I'm a big sexy bastard. I genuinely don't think I'm a big sexy bastard. You know what I mean? That's just the character. I'm investing into a character. You know what I mean? And I'm just hoping that people understand that it's the character that I'm investing in, and it's no me changing as an actual person.
Yeah, it's right. There's a lot to unpack in that whole bit because I've so many other questions. But the Patrick Petersky asked a question which I think may be related to this fella. Have you ever gotten under a fan's skin so much that he's taken his own glasses off, snapped them, and thrown them at you?
Well, that was the exact guy I'm talking about. Literally, the guy got that invested. He took his own glasses off, snapped them into 2 pieces, and launched these glasses right at me. His own glasses. So that's how much the guy gets invested into the heat.
That's amazing. And the fact that this guy, like, yes, he said some insensitive things, and that's been dealt with, as far as I've been made aware. But the fact that he doesn't step the line, like, he knows that's his seating area.
Aye.
That is where you do your thing there. He does his thing there. Gets
I
carried
mean, don't get
away.
me wrong. I'll be honest. It was only a couple of days ago. I actually found the guy on Facebook, and I messaged him, and I'd actually messaged him to thank him for his involvement and his investment into the like the characters and stuff, and just seeing how people like him make my job worth doing, and it also makes my job easier. You know what I mean? And he's like, "Oh, mate, oh, thank you. I can't believe this. You've made my day. This is amazing. Thank you ever so much. I'll see you at the next show." You know what I mean? So just things like that.
I was hoping his reply was just going to be "fuck you."
So was, to be honest, so was I. So was I. But no.
But yeah, you got all that going on, and then you come up and do W3L shows, and I think the thing when I saw you were revealed as in NAK, when you're mentioned like that 50% thing going on, the thing that kind of went made me go, "That's an interesting choice," is because NAK has always been kind of dirty characters, you know, tattooed, dirty, grungy kind of thing going on, and then you're very much fit, clean cut, and all that kind of stuff, and handsome. I'll say it for you. Don't worry.
Oh, thank you.
So it just like it's too much. You see Cavero, and who's kind of that tattooed kind of monster vibe, and then but seeing the reactions, the shows, it's like, yeah, there's a reason why you're there, because there's that side of you that is just an absolute bastard, or the side that you personally you don't like. You can generate that kind of the fact that you've got someone actually destroying their own property to tell you that you're the worst person in the world. That's just like incredible.
And it's like I say, it's just obviously other people's, like, there could be people out there watching that video that I've just described, where you see me and the guy literally roaring and cursing and swearing at each other and go, "That wrestler's taking that a wee bit too far." But again, it's that investment. You know what I mean? It's totally that investment that the fans have got. It's loyalty and it's a passion. So again, we're putting on a show. That's what we do. We're entertainers, man. You know what I mean? People need to remember that.
We do have a couple more questions about your current character, which is from Lily. She's asked, "What's it like to be balding?"
Ah, well, so apparently I'm balding. Apparently. I've only just found this out on Sunday at VALOR. But, no, like, I'm no balding. I'm growing my hair out. I'm no biting to that. I'm no biting to that, Lily. No chance. Go on, no. I don't need your gummies either. She had a sign. She had a sign at VALOR. Irn Dru needs hair growth gummies. He's balding. How dare you? again, that was another interaction. Again, I put the video online. You know what I mean? I walk up after the match. I'm like, "Right, so where do you get these gummies then?" And she's like, "Oh, Amazon, blah, blah." And I'm like, "Well, how come you know I'm balding and I don't know I'm balding? How are you giving me this information?" I mean, just being like, just being a cocky prick. Mm-hmm. Just being a dick. And I'm like, "Ah, listen, you've never seen a sexier bastard than me. Like, just being a pure asshole." You know what I mean? And again, it was the reaction of getting it. You know what I mean?
I mean, I recently had on the podcast August Artois, and that part of the show, but being a cheeky bastard about it, that's just something that I really loved what he was doing, and I'm loving, like, you're doing that. Someone's taking the piss out of you in the video. I'll fucking retweet it. I'll repost it. Give me your reaction. I don't care. Aye. Kind of thing. It's phenomenal, and it just makes people want to see you more. Because if I'm not, I've never been to a Valor show. It's definitely on my list to get to as soon as I can afford or can go. And like, I'm seeing these yourselves. I'm seeing the NAK. I'm seeing what God's country is doing and things like that. And I'm like, fuck, this is amazing. This is, I need to be at the show now because of their social media presence, which is, it's just how you get bums in seats at the end of the day.
Exactly.
Right. Let's see if we've got any more questions I could throw in at this point. We've got It's Myron XX asking what your opinion was when you found out who the fourth member of the NAK was, Seb Silvers.
I was kind of taken back because I was thinking he's being built up as the the top babyface from Sweden. He's meant to be like the Swedish supernova. So I kind of, at first I was, I thought, I don't really understand it, to be fair. And then the more, like you say, how the more you see the change in NAK, you're thinking, well, you've got the more clean cut athletic style of myself, and you've got Cavaro, and you've got the original Renfrew, and I'm thinking, I think maybe Seb Silver's, he might bring even more to what NAK is potentially going to grow to be. So it also opens up the doors to NAK traveling more out, so to Sweden, and NAK getting a name in Sweden with Seb Silver's representing. So aye, the initial thought, I was kind of like, oh, I don't know how that would work. But like now, as time's gone on and you see the changes and the storyline ideas, and you're like, this is going to put bums on seats.
So moving away from that, then generally, like a lot of your like middle portion of your career was a lot in England, WAW for the Knights. Recently, though, you're really starting to properly split your time between the two. Is it that excitement again about the Scottish scene that's kind of had you pursuing bookings or people approaching you? Is the Scottish scene like exciting you again, and you wanting to compete here more than the down Norwich?
To be honest, aye, the Scottish scene does excite me, but that's not the reason. The reason is more so now that I'm being contacted more by promoters in Scotland to work for them. Whereas when I was younger, I was a bit naive, and I had a bit of a bad attitude, and I thought I was a bit of a Mr. Know-it-all, and I kind of burnt a lot of bridges and stuff. So I went down when I first started going down to Norwich in 2013. Yeah, 2013. That was kind of I wanted to try a new place, see where I could go. And I turned up there with the exact same attitude and the naivety that I had when I was in Scotland. And that very quickly changed, you know what I mean? Got all the opportunities that I did, got the experiences that I did through WAW. Then obviously more opportunities simply because of the amount of work that I was doing down south with WW, traveling up and down the UK, doing all the camp seasons and stuff, getting obviously the opportunity to wrestle people like Scotty Tuhoti, Gangrel, EC3, I mean, being in the main event of their biggest show of the year, people started noticing things. So obviously then promoters would then contact me and ask me, like, I would then start contacting promoters as well. I'm not going to sit here and say that I've sat on my arse and done nothing. I still to this day reach out to promoters to try and get more bookings. But it's to the point now where, unfortunately, myself and WAW have parted ways. So they'll probably, as much as I regret to say, you probably won't see me in WAW again. I'll be forever grateful for every opportunity that they gave me and stuff like that. But now it's just time to try and focus on getting my name in Scotland and becoming one of the top wrestlers in Scotland.
I mean, speaking of travelling up and down, of course, I've seen you wrestle a few times now in Elgin for W3L. Yeah. And the thing about yourself, right, so the first time I saw you wrestle, I think it was a Bishop Millhalls show, possibly. Cold as fuck venue. But the people were just absolutely electric. I don't know if it's because of the branding, really, the Irn Dru branding and the Irn Bruness and all that. But every time you've wrestled in Elgin, you've got the biggest reactions of the night, generally. And
thank you.
And with that, as well, I think it's also because you bring the crowd in, because Hugo Harris has unfortunately had his nuts crushed against a ring post, I think, at least twice. And that, right. I've seen up here because of you coercing everyone to be involved. What's it like going into a new town, into like an Elgin, an unknown crowd to yourself, and then getting a huge reaction, like without doing an awful lot? Is there just like, well, that's going to be an easy night, or you just like, what's the kind of thoughts going into that?
To be honest, it is a very, very surreal feeling. For me, it's like the when I walk through the curtain and like you say, I get that you could probably see my eyes are tearing up. You saying that, by the way, I genuinely appreciate that. But like once he, it's what I was taught with Ricky Knight and Zack Knight and Soraya Knight. Once you've got the crowd right in the palm of your hand, you want to keep them there. Obviously, during the match, you're not going to have a constant noise level. So you need to try and engage and try and learn how to work with the fans. Do you know what I mean? So I give the Knight so much credit for the wrestler that I've become, because I've managed to be able to cater to an audience, whether it be family friendly, kids, whatever. And I mean, it's like you say, I don't do anything different to anybody else, but especially in W3L, like there's been many a times when I'm not blowing smoke up my own arse. There's been many a times when I've been sitting backstage, the fans are in, the show hasn't even started, and there's an Irn Dru chant, and I'm thinking, what the hell is going on here? Like, that's no me, that's no fun, that I don't understand it. So going into a new town and getting a massive reaction as if like they know who I am, it's sort of a like, okay, don't take that, like, take this with a pinch of salt. They don't know who you are, but make sure they don't forget who you are now. Go out there, entertain them, and just be yourself.
I think like what I found, because I've went to the W3L shows up here for, first one I went to was 2012, and I've went every year to him because it's literally around the corner from my house. It's very easy to get. But the fact that I think until the last couple of years, I didn't realise that the crowd does remember. I mean, of course I do. I'm a big nerd who's got a website. I know what's happening. Right. I know who's on these shows. But the fact that every year you've came back, bigger reactions. And I think that was underappreciated, because last year, Mark Monroe was a bad guy, and he came back this year trying to be a good guy, and Elgin Lodge went, nah, we're not cheering you. So I think it goes to show that if you make an impression, yeah, if you come back a year later, 6 months later, like, we'll remember what we're supposed to do. But yeah, it's been, hopefully we'll see you again. I think it's end of November. I think it's
I think it is.
They've got like Tim Strange and Nina Samuels, and that's like,
yep,
that's surreal in itself. And the Bishop Mill Hall, and the tiny Bishop Mill Hall, that we're going to have Nina Samuels and Tim Strange. Wrestling's weird, especially Bishop Mill, Bishop Mill Hall. Anyway, loads more questions, so we'll try and work my way around them, because they're literally everywhere. So I think that's the Facebook one for Patrick done, so I'll get rid of that, one of my tabs there. We've got Kerry Ann Hedden asking, on behalf of her son Lewis, just to ask you who your favourite wrestler was growing up.
My favourite wrestler growing up was Shawn Michaels, 100%, no matter what. Right? Heartbreak Kid, Shawn Michaels. You could tell with the long hair, I used the super kick. You might see a wee bit of 1997 Shawn Michaels and the current NAK Irn Dru. Shawn Michaels, all-time favourite. All-time.
That does not shock me in the slightest. I think we probably discussed this in the last time as well in the chat. Is there any plans for the whole 97 pleats? You know, just go all out. Go for it.
We'll see.
Well, I mean, I might not be able to, because once you pull the hair back, good bald spot, you know.
I'm not even balding. I'm growing it out. That's why I wear my hats for now. We'll see.
I have no right to make these jokes, because this is a full head of hair. I always get, like, my wife never believes me, and every time we go to a hairdresser, not for me, but obviously, I go, I've got a full head of hair, and they check, and they go, yeah, you do. It's just really fair. It's like, exactly. Full head of hair. anyway, so right, let's go scrolling more. so many. We've got Borderline Panda Martinez on Instagram asking, not really a question, but just wanted to say your merch is awesome. And shout out to Wayne.
Thank you very much. I shout out to Wayne Dennison over at Unforgettable Vision. Absolute fantastic graphic designer. Wow. Anybody needing any work done, I highly recommend unforgettablevision.com.
That's where the, like, you've got loads of merch, like everything from bikinis to socks. You've got everything.
Yep.
I'm seeing the new age clicks got all that kind of stuff as well. Just, yeah, if you want something with your logo on it, go to Unforgettable Vision, because it seems to be, you can get it. If you think of it is there.
It's there.
We've got It's Myring again asking if you could sit down for a meal with any wrestler, dead or alive, who would it be and why? I'm going to make this harder for you. Not Shawn Michaels.
Right, okay. Dusty Rhodes. Just to pick his brain, just to learn, just to be educated. The man was a genius.
I didn't see the I haven't seen the pictures of the bunkhouse brawl, but were you jeans, elbow, knee pads over the top? Did you go all in?
Knee pads over. I believe the knee pads were over the top. I had the cowboy boots on. I had the jeans on. Aye.
Just had them in the cupboard, waiting for the day.
That was it.
We've got Claire Murray asking, what do you like the most about wrestling?
I'll answer that as a fan and as a wrestler. So I'll answer that as two parts. As a fan, just the larger than life characters, the believing in the superhero like characters. You know what I mean? Like, growing up for me, you had the Ultimate Warrior, Papa Shango, the Bushido. It was all characters, they were gimmicks. You know what I mean? Papa Shango putting a curse on the Ultimate Warrior, and the Ultimate Warrior spitting out black ooze. You're like, oh my god! You know what I mean? Like, things like Doink the Clown. Doink the Clown was one of my favourites. I don't know why. I just loved Doink the Clown. He was an evil bastard, but I like Doink the Clown. You know what I mean? I believe he's my mum's favourite as well, for some strange reason.
Mums don't have a guide of what they like. One of my mum's favourite wrestlers is Grandmaster Sexy. I never understood why, but there we go.
Oh, Mama Strachan. But aye, so, like, as a fan, it's the entertainment, the larger-than-life soap opera with the violence and just the generic stuff. As a wrestler, right now, my favourite thing about wrestling is walking through the curtain and the crowd just erupting, whether it's mainly when I'm a good guy. It's more of a good feeling when you walk through the curtain, you don't even need to say anything, and they know exactly who you are, and you don't even get a word in to try even say, like for instance, like, oh, hello, Elgin, like, you don't even get the chance, they've just erupted. So for me, it's the crowd, 100% the crowd.
It must be incredible, like, especially with the New Age Click stuff. Like, at the most recent show, you were in a match unannounced. It was 808s, 808s and Rope Breaks, I think it was.
That's right.
You and Cavero ended up being injected in matches. And what I loved about it, if I remember rightly, is when I read the results, I was like, I can't wait to see the footage of this, because the two matches that you were, like, injected yourself into, were both matches that had, like, friends of Luke King Sharp in them. And I was reading the results going, oh, I bet that was, like, as soon as music hit and everything like that, bet you were just, the atmosphere must have just went, like, chilling in that moment. Which it must have been just an incredible feeling. I'm just double checking, where was it? So Fatal 4-Way was Cavero, and it was Krieger. You got jumped, yep. It was in that one. And then your one had Jimmy Pierce, of course, looking Sharp's cousin. I was like,
yep.
Oh man, that is
when I walked out halfway through the match, my music played.
That's just, as far as storytelling goes in wrestling, that's the sort of shit I like. That's that just little thing where you just go, oh wait, but, and you read it and go, oh. So yeah, I can't wait for these episodes to go on YouTube as soon as possible, because I need to see them. Right, where else are we? We've got Lily again. How does it feel to know Legends Never Die are better than NAK?
How do we know legends never die are better than the NAK when they've never even stepped in the ringways?
There we go. So there's the answer to that. What was it like putting looking sharp in the back of a taxi? In the boot of a taxi, I should say.
Worrying. Very worrying. And the only reason at the time, it wasn't worrying to begin with, because I thought, all right, this is going to work well. Because it was supposed to be throw him in the back seat, no throw him in the boot. But if you watch, if, I don't know if you've seen the video or if you've watched the match back, literally 10 seconds after we take that fight to the outside, the police are there. All it took was for that police van to be sitting around the corner watching us, and then they see three big, massive guys grabbing a tiny wee guy, throwing him in the boot of a taxi, and then seeing why the big guys, me, roaring at the taxi driver to fucking drive. Fucking drive! I genuinely, I was like, shit, we're going to get the jail. We're going to get the fucking jail. Goes back into the venue, continues the match, and totally forgot that we just bunged him in the back of a taxi, because he was back at the back of the venue already.
That adrenaline rush must just be like,
wow,
the best thing.
I mean, again, I only noticed it when I watched the footage back for that match, but you see the fight spills out into the street. Then you see the fans coming. And then you see all the cars are all going beep, 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 and they're all hanging out, they're windy shouting stuff. And there's a pub across the road. The pub empties. People are coming out the pub and standing and watching us wrestle in the street. There's an Uber Eats driver on his bike, and he's flagging down his pals to come and watch. And we've literally got the full, like, that area of Paisley Road West watching us in Glasgow. And then the next thing, you just see us bunging Lou King Sharp in the back of a taxi and screaming at the taxi driver to fucking drive. Can you imagine how terrified that taxi driver was? Throwing, just flagging down a taxi, he stops, you grab somebody, throw him into your boot and fucking scream at him to drive, and he drove away. He fucking drove. He must have been shitting himself.
I say, that must be the more worrying bit, that he just said, okay, oh no, we need to get back.
Aye. Aye, like, wow.
If your initial plan was backseat, I can just imagine the atmosphere shouting at him, drive off a little bit, and then Lou just kind of sit up going, can you take me around there?
I just run the corner, run the corner.
Aye, but the fact that you threw him in the boot. Oh man, I love wrestling. And the fact that that happened, like everyone jumping out, I mean, that was probably like 50 tickets sold for the next Paisley show that night, just for that.
It was in the Glasgow Live, you know what I mean? It was covered by that, you know what I mean? It's like, wow. So I got a wee bit of publicity.
Being able to like feel that and being part of that and all that kind of stuff, is that something that you can look back at Max Mayhem and look back at all the maybe bridges you've burnt and all that, going, fuck it, I may have changed one or two things, but fuck it, it's worth it. I'm here.
Aye.
In a crowd.
100%. 100%. 100%. The only way is up right now for me. The only way is up.
It seems there's no stopping you, because I see all these opportunities in the last year, at the very least, and this 2025 is going to be, especially just seeing where this NAK stuff goes, and then with that, with the opportunities you get elsewhere and stuff like that, off the back of it and off that kind of buzz. It's very, very exciting. Speaking of someone buzzing, giving you the buzz, we've got Big Buffer. He sent a message in, saying thank you. Thank you, Big Dru. My brother, we connected so much over the summer. Brother for life. Buffa, man, what a guy. What a character. What a larger than life kind of guy.
Yep.
It was like being on the road with them, because, of course, again, I saw you guys, obviously separate matches, but again, up my way.
That's right. Well, to be honest, like, Buffa actually stayed at my house for the whole time he was here. So Buffa, me and Buffa, we got on, we bonded very well. We literally became like brothers. You know what I mean? The guy was no trouble at all. Very knowledgeable. Taught me a lot just by speaking about wrestling. The man is so underrated as a wrestler. 100% underrated. My personal beliefs is he should be up there on the top. He should be in the main, the big mountain. He should be up there. The guy's unbelievable. Phenomenal worker. Good attitude. Great guy, honestly. Wow. Bye. Genuinely, it was a pleasure getting to know him and having him here.
I love that he's spent a lot of his time in China and then over into Europe and then into the UK. I'm glad I'm loved that I saw he's going to take an extended trip back to the US. I feel like it's almost like he's done his excursion now. He's going to go Aye. And Aye. Go and make it big in the US, like he should have been way back when. So that's yeah. I had him on the podcast. I just got to see him wrestle. I love Booper. We'll see what he does next. Last question, I think, is from Lily, and then we'll maybe dive about other subjects. Anyone in the Scottish scene you've got your eye on to wrestle right now?
Nah.
Nah, just taking it as
and
it comes.
This might come across as arrogant, but no. I will happily wrestle anybody. You put anybody in a match, I will work with anybody. And I don't, and there's just, right now, there's nobody that's literally stood up and went, I've gone, oh, I need to have a match with him. You know what I mean? So there's so many guys out there that have got a lot of great potential. You know what I mean? But just now, going back to what we were saying, obviously, going forward, I'm concentrating on bettering myself just now. So, aye. But again, it's an open door. I will wrestle anybody. Literally, I will give me a 2 week trainee. I'll wrestle anybody. I'm happy to put on a show for anybody as long as you're entertained. Then I'm happy.
Coming to mind, like the money match in Valor right now has got to be like yourself and BT, just for the whole history that can be thrown into it and all that kind of stuff. You and BT Gun, because I was just having a wee look at the cage match, which I know is missing a lot of things, but I was saying there's no matches with BT Gun, so I don't know if you have wrestled them, who may have been
yes
quite early on or just lost in the archives.
The match is actually on YouTube.
Oh, fantastic. Well done, cage match.
And it's Max Mayhem versus BT Gun, and it was, I believe, 2010. And it was for the PBW heavyweight title, and it was an Academy Attack show.
Max Mayhem apparently didn't exist between the years 2008 and 2011.
No, so. He didn't, apparently. Me and BT Gunn, BT Gunn's a very good, he's a very good friend of mine. They always looked out for me coming up in the business and stuff. He was one of the ones that if I spoke out of turn or if I was being a wee dick, BT Gunn was one of the only, like, there was only a handful of people. BT Gunn was one of them, like, listen, stop being a wee dick. You know what I mean? Plain and simple, just get me told. Mm-hmm. But, like, even to this day, like, we'll turn up to a show, could be any show. And, oh, how are we doing? But who are you working? Oh, we're working such and such. Oh, who are you working? Oh, I'm working him. You know, I just asked the promoter if we can we not just work each other? Can we not just, oh, I just work you? And we're going, oh, I know, mate, I know. Just trying. It's an ongoing like joke that we it's not an ongoing joke, but we joke about it, saying how like you've got us two guys on a show, put us on together, let us put on a fucking, again, like in my opinion, BT Gunn's in an elite level. So obviously, like going back to Lily's question, like as an end, I've got my own BT Gunn's an elite level. Do you know what I mean? He can hang with the best of the best. He has been in the ring with the best of the best. So, you know what I mean? Aye, obviously, anybody would want to wrestle BT Gunn, of course. I mean,
it used to be a theme that's went through this season of podcasts is the phrase iron sharpens iron, which works for because you're Irn Dru. But that seems to be the consensus now, where maybe a couple of years ago it would have been, oh, I'm getting to wrestle so and so, I'll be fun. But there seems to be a real serious, like, consensus now that because of things like AEW and Wembley, things like NXT UK, yeah, it fizzled out, but you know, the fact that opportunities are available, that you could see you in NXT, you could see you in AEW, you could see you go to Japan, we're seeing what like Jack Morris is doing over in Noah, like if you want to be a wrestler, if you want to make a serious living as a wrestler, it seems to be that's just the thought now. You've got to find people that are better than you to kind of Highlander your way up the movie. Highlander your way up the ladder.
100%, 100% agree, 100%.
It's just fantastic. It's fantastic to see because you get the. But when it comes to opponents, though, like you kind of you mark your progress against. I notice Johnny Storm pops up quite a lot in your kind of back catalogue of matches, and you kind of wrestle him every couple of years. Is that kind of an opponent where you can go right? I wrestled him 3 years ago. Wrestling him now, you can see where your markers of improvements are.
I like again. I remember the first time I looked Johnny Storm. Johnny controlled the whole match. Told me where to be, the spots, you know what I mean? Asked me what my moves were. It's the general census of veteran and rookie, you know what I mean? The veteran takes full control. And then the next time you wrestle Johnny, it gives me a little bit more freedom to become creative. You work him again and again and again, and it gets to the point where you're like, what do you want to do for a finish? Kill. Generic heat? Yep. Get this, do this one, or do you want to do that? We'll fucking call it out there. So you've got you build that level of experience with somebody, you know what I mean? So like I believe that like for instance BT Gun, I believe he's another guy where I could just say, wait, what do you want to do for a finish? Right, we'll do that. Generic heat, cool. Come back, hot spot, shine. Ah fuck it, we'll just call it out there. Let's just feel the crowd. You know what I mean? Adam Shame's another one. Me and Adam Shame have worked with each other 4 or 5 times in the past 2 or 3 years. Me and Adam Shame did not plan a single fucking thing. But I just knew Adam Shame had that ability to go out there and call a match in the ring. So me and Adam Shame done that.
It's an incredible skill. I don't think it gets mentioned enough that wrestlers have that skill. And then can see wrestlers that don't have that skill. It's very evident.
I mean, by all means, I'm not going to sit here and say that I could call a match in the ring with absolutely anybody. That's not the case. You know what I mean? That's not the case at all. But like, there's been times when I've done like at training, like I'm one of the assistant coaches at the Looking Sharp Excellence Dojo of Excellence, and there's been times where I'll grab Big Felton King and we jump in the ring, and I'll just say, right, we're going to wrestle for 5 minutes. And we do a 5-minute match off the cuff, and he's like, "I don't know how am I able to do that?" Like I says, because you feel the person that you're working, you just feel the movement, and you don't overthink things. Just slow everything down. You know what I mean? But like I say, I'm not going to sit here and say that I'm a fucking ultra professional because I can call a match off the cuff. There's only certain people you can do that with.
Yeah. I mean, it comes to like watching wrestling and thinking that. Like when you see these documentaries about WWE and that, and they go, like, main event WrestleMania, oh, we'll just call out there. And I'm like, whoa, no. You kind of think that'd be my first thought going, no. I think I would, if for whatever reason, somehow I went back in time and got fit and tried the wrestling without just doing this instead, I'd probably be like the DDP Randy Savage school of, no, I want everything. I might forget some of it. I want it at least in writing that so I know what I'm doing. I'd be terrible. You'd hate me, to be honest. I'd be there asking you loads of questions, like right up. You're not getting in the zone or anything. I'll just be there going, "We do this after this. We do this." Yeah, I wouldn't get booked anywhere.
But that's the thing. There's been many people that I've been wrestling. I sometimes do that. Mm-hmm. I'll be like, right, am I right in saying we do this, and then that? And they'll go, no, we do this, we do that, then we do that. I'm like, fuck, actually, fuck. You know what I mean? There's been many a times I've been like that. You know what I mean? I'm not going to sit here and say that I'm a perfection. I'm not putting, nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect.
I mean, it goes back to the EC3 thing. Like, again, you're both sat there. They're both lying down there just going, what's next? And both he's going, fuck those.
Fuck no, brother.
We mentioned things like that. You mentioned Scott Hoy, you mentioned Gangrel, EC3, all those kind of big name opponents. Obviously, Shawn Michaels would be the ultimate, which, you know, never say never. It could happen. You could be at the performance center. He might want to roll in the ring for 5 minutes. Would that
you
be
never
enough?
Know. Never know.
Would that be enough if we just went, oh, well, of whatever. I don't want to do an impression of Shawn Michaels because that would be just horrible. But like, if you just you were at the performance center for whatever reason, and you went, "Oh, I could get it for 5 minutes with you." If there was a point where we went, "Right, we're not going to sign you," would you be able to go, "I think I'm all right. I think I've peaked wrestling now. I think I could probably just go home."
That wee inner child in me, but aye. Fucking right.
So usually I ask people like, what's on your bucket list, where you want to go, but by the sounds of it, you just want to wrestle anywhere and everyone. But going forward then, what is your goals then? So not a place or opponent, but what is your goals coming up that you want to try and hit and maximise?
I mean, I get asked, like, what's the ultimate goal all the time? And it's always the same answer. It'll never change. So I'll stick with that. And it'll be, I just want to be remembered. That's it. That is it. I've never seen a giant haystacks match live. I've never seen a Nature Boy Buddy Rogers match live. You know what I mean? Like, I don't even think I've been alive when Nature Boy Buddy Rogers was alive, but I know who these people are. You know what I mean? When you start thinking, like, if unless you're a genuine wrestling fan, like, you don't know who, to today's generation, people don't know who Terry Funk is. They don't know who Jack Briscoe is. You know what I mean? Maybe your smart marks that are growing up with, like, dads that are smart marks or whatever, mums that are smart marks, or if they're involved in the business some way. I just want to be remembered. I want to be, when people think about Scottish wrestling, they go, "Do you remember that guy, Irn Dru? He was like the Hulk Hogan of Scottish wrestling." By all means, I'm not saying I'm the Hulk Hogan of Scottish wrestling, because that's Grado, and Grado will always hold that. But I want to be known as, well, for instance, look at Grado. Grado will now or forever be known because of just who he is, because how much charisma the guy's got and just how fantastic the guy is. You know what I mean? Look at the stuff that he's doing.
You want to be the guy,
I want to be remembered.
You want to be the guy where W3L tours here in 20 years' time, under new management probably, because surely Mike's going to retire by that point. Who knows? He probably will still be here. He'll still be wrestling as well, probably. And you want to be the guy that folk are in the pub afterwards going, "Oh, I remember going to these shows and there was that Irn Dru Marshall who came out and he headbutted a guy that came out with a mirror and it was the best thing I've ever seen." That's it, the legacy.
I want a legacy. I want to be remembered. Whether it's for NAK Irn Dru, whether it's for, like, just normal Irn Dru, whatever. Fucking, if I come up with a reinvention of Irn Dru, whatever it is, I just want to be remembered as Irn Dru. Not even just Irn Dru, just be remembered.
I don't think we can ask any further question that's gonna like top that as the kind of closing off point. So I think for my money, you're always gonna be remembered because you were my first interview on this podcast, on this website, when I started it. So you're always gonna have a wee soft spot in my heart is Irn Dru Marshall. But where can people find out more about Irn Dru? And just plug all your shit. Plug all the merch as well. Just plug everything.
Right. So you've got Facebook at Irn Dru 92, I believe. That's the Dru Marshall page. Instagram is at Scottish Superman. Is X Twitter, whatever it's called. I don't actually use it. I don't use that. But I'm sure that's Irn Dru 92 as well. TikTok, which I should really get back into using because that seems to be like beneficial. Again, Irn Dru 92. If you want to get any merchandise, you go to unforgettablevision.com, go to the rosters page and click on Irn Dru. And all your merchandise ranges, like Billy covered earlier, from bikinis to socks to beach towels, t-shirts, can koozies, steel tumblers. There's so much stuff that's going to be coming and going. There's loads of stuff there. There's loads of different t-shirt designs and aye.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me, and I'm glad that we got
a proper
chatting. You're in the comfort of your own home instead of at an airport, like last time. But no, great. Have a good one. Thank you.
Thank you very much, man. Cheers, bro. Speak soon.